The views expressed on the following broadcasts do not necessarily reflect those of KHLT, Take 12 Radio, or our affiliates. The opinions on this show should not be considered as medical, psychological, or professional advice and are those of the host, co-host, and guest. Take 12 Radio and KHLT Recovery Broadcasting are not affiliated with any particular 12-step fellowship.
The past is behind us. What has been now is gone. But right now is with us, and we must carry on. And when regret closes in, I don't see what might have been. I see grace, and I know whatever comes, He'll make a way. This time, this is what counts. This is what our life is about.
Welcome to the Victory Report, a presentation of Take 12 Recovery Radio, featuring the men and women of Teen Challenge of Arizona, sharing their experience, strength, and hope as it relates to overcoming life-controlling issues by the power and grace of Jesus Christ. And now, here are your hosts, the Mighty Man and Denver Wolf.
One and all, it is great to have you with us. I am the Monty Man, your host for this episode of the Victory Report. My colleague Denver Wolf is on sabbatical, and we wish him well while he is taking a much-deserved break, working on recovery issues. Don't you know that we all need to hone our recovery skills because we are in a battle? And it is a battle that has already been won, but God will not render us white as snow without our cooperation. So we need to take a break sometimes and take care of ourselves, and that's what Denver's doing. And so I get to solo this this episode with you, and I'm so glad I do. Listen, this month on the show, we have a very special guest. Rebecca Owen is with us. She is the executive assistant to the Executive State Director of Teen Challenge Arizona, the Reverend Snow Peabody. And we're going to be talking with her here in just a few minutes. But I have a request for all of you. Listen, the recovery community within the world is extremely large. And one of the things that we have been able to do as a recovery radio station is, on occasion, call on you, the recovery community, to come alongside us and help us to help somebody else. And I have a special request today. A former guest of mine on the Take 12 Recovery Radio show, Steve Wolman, who did a show on this broadcast, or one of our broadcasts at Take 12 Radio, on geriatric substance abuse, which was an eye-opener to all of us. Because who knew that people up in their retirement years, 65 and older, may be struggling still with substance use disorders? And Steve was on the show and did an incredible job of giving us some wonderful information about the seriousness of substance abuse disorders amongst elderly people. Well, Stephen has requested something, and bless his heart, let me just read to you his email that he sent to me. He said, "Hi, Monty, it's Steve Wolman. I did a geriatric substance abuse radio spot with you a couple of years ago. I was wondering if you could do me a big favor. Right now, I am having a God forbid moment in my life. My father is dying, and due to illnesses in my family, I have been financially drained on top of becoming disabled myself. But this isn't about me. My father is in hospice. He is a Korean War veteran, and he wants to die at home. I really want to grant him that one wish, but I'm not able to. I set up a GoFundMe page to raise the money to get him home for his short time. I hate asking favors of anyone, but I know that the recovery community has the ability to come through. Could you mention his GoFundMe page on your radio show? I hope I'm not asking too much, but we need support from the recovery community right now. And let me just answer the call to this. Yes, absolutely. Now, if you know Take 12 Radio, you know we've been doing this. We're going on 16 years of broadcasting. We have the integrity of really a board of directors, an advisory board, the people that know what they're doing. This is not a scam. This is not a fundraiser to try to get your money and it's all a lie or any of that kind of stuff. Steve and his father, Bob, really need your help. Now, listen, Bob is 85 years old. He's a Korean War veteran. He is currently in hospice, and his wish is that he can go back home and live out his remaining days with his family and his beloved dog, Pumpkin. And listen, our veterans, they were there for us. Maybe it's time that we're there for them. And here's an opportunity to do that. So listeners, all of you who are in the recovery community, here is the GoFundMe page. It's GoFundMe.com. Now listen closely. /his-journey-home-bob-womans, that's WOLLMANS-wish. Now, if you don't remember that, you can rewind the show and play that back, or you can go to our website at take12radio.com, that's T-A-K-E, the number 12, radio.com, and click on the link that says Send Bob Home. And that'll take you to the GoFundMe page. Any amount, no amount's too small. Search your heart. Please pray about it. Let's gather as a recovery community and help send this wonderful war veteran home to be with his family to live out his last days with him and his beloved pup. Would you please? I would appreciate it so very, very much. And I know the Womans would appreciate it as well. All right, we're going to take a short break. And when we come back, we're going to have a little fun. And then we're going to interview Rebecca Owen, the executive assistant to the executive state director of Teen Challenge of Arizona. When we come back, don't go away. Listen to this important message about our veterans.
In the fabric of America, they are the toughest threads, our bravest, and most selfless. They raised their hands, stepped forward, and served for each other, for you, and me. One of the first things they learned was the code that every service member lives by. Leave no one behind. Now all of us need to live by it too. Because some veterans are being left behind. 20 of them take their own lives every day. Why? It's not simple. It never is. What matters is that we're there for them, just like they were there for us. A handshake, a phone call, a simple gesture make a big difference to a veteran in crisis. Learn how to be there for a veteran at betheforeveterans.com. Honor the code. Be there. Leave no one behind.
Time. This is what counts. This is what our...
All righty. Welcome back to the show. You have tuned in to Take 12 Recovery Radio's The Victory Report, where we feature the men and women of Teen Challenge of Arizona sharing their experience, strength, and hope, what it was like, what happened, and what it's like today as it relates to overcoming life-controlling issues. Now, we know that addiction is the biggest, the largest health crisis in our world today, and because of stigma, recovery from it gets the least amount of attention. And Take 12 Recovery Radio, the Ministry of Teen Challenge, Adult and Teen Challenge, and Teen Challenge USA all over the world are helping to break that stigma. And so today on the phone is Rebecca Owen, and she's going to be sharing her experience, strength, and hope with us. Rebecca, welcome to the show.
Good morning. Thank you.
Yeah, you bet. I'm so glad that you've taken the time out of your busy schedule. And I know, because I, too, am in the employ of Teen Challenge, and we do stay busy, do we not?
Yes, we do. There's always miracles that happen every day and things to be done.
That's right. Well, before we get into your story, we like to have a little icebreaker and have a little fun with a little Teen Challenge trivia. So I'm going to call on our friend Cecil. Cecil, are you there?
Yes. Yes, Monty Man, I'm here. I have a little frog in my throat today, so excuse me.
Okay.
So, Mr. Producer, will you cue the Arizona Western cowboy music, please? Thank you. We have some Teen Challenge trivia that we want to try to stump Rebecca. We want to try to stump her and see if she can get them right or if she gets them all wrong. So here we go. Take it away, the Monty Man. Excuse me.
Well, Cecil, I hope you get over your cold there. Thank you so much, Cecil. You're always a hoot. Well, we're going to play some Teen Challenge trivia here and see if we can't stump Rebecca. Rebecca, you've got, let's see, one, two, three. You have four trivia questions and a bonus question. Now, if you get if you get them all right, Rebecca, you know what we're going to give you? Any idea?
A high five.
Well, not even that. We're not going to give you nothing, Rebecca. Nothing at all, except for good job.
I'm hoping.
Yeah. There's no prizes. There's no vacations. There's no cars to win. It's just good job. But I'll tell you what you're going to get every time you get an answer right, you're going to get a cowbell. And if you get it wrong, you get the fluff machine. And so you don't want to get the fluff machine because it's kind of fluffy, and we don't want to do that. So let's go for the cowbell. All right, and more cowbells. Here is Teen Challenge trivia question number one, and these will be multiple choice. Okay, according to Teen Challenge USA, throughout the years, studies have been conducted about the adult and teen challenge programs and process. These studies have found that two of the biggest reasons our students are still sober after leaving Teen Challenge is, and here are your choices, A, support groups and medication, B, their faith in God and the support of family, or C, active ministry and a local church.
Ooh.
So A, support groups and medication.
I'm going to go with B.
With B, their faith in God and the support of family? Final answer?
No, my final answer might be C.
You going to go with C? Active ministry in a local church?
I'm going to stick with B.
Stick with B. Well, it's a good thing you did, Rebecca, because that is the two reasons that are mostly given for their continued sobriety. So good job. You got the first one right. All right. Whew. Trivia question number two. Addiction is characterized by a progressive loss of control over the use of a substance or behavior. The user becomes obsessed with the substance or behavior despite adverse consequences and vigorously denies the existence of a problem if confronted. According to the philosophy of Teen Challenge, a man or woman can do what if they trust God, clean house, and serve others? So what can they do? And here are your choices. A, stop using drugs but never quit, stop wanting drugs. B, stay abstinent from mind-altering substances and fully recover. Or C, always be somewhat plagued by their addictive behaviors.
Can you repeat A again?
You bet. Stop using drugs but never quite stop wanting them. B.
So my answer is B.
B, you would be correct. stay abstinent from mind-altering substances and fully recover is the correct answer. All right, you got two. You're doing good. All right, here's number three. While many think it is the combination of both the length of the program, which is 12 to 18 months in residential centers, and the faith-based environment that helps people to overcome life-controlling problems, we believe it is something even more personal. We call this what? And here are your choices. A, the Jesus factor. B, the discipline factor. Or C, the accountability factor.
I'm going to go with A, Jesus factor.
And you would be correct. Very good. Hey, you're doing awesome. Yeah. All right, Snow, if you're listening to this, you better get ready to give her a bonus. Yeah, that is true. A big cowbell. We believe that when people develop a relationship with Jesus, everything changes for them. This means that new priorities, attitudes, reactions, plans, and goals in life all add up to cause real change. A new life in Christ and incorporating biblical principles for daily living replace the old lifestyles, attitudes, and behaviors, and we do call that the Jesus factor. All right, here is number four. The year was 1967. The town was Garrison, New York. The mission of Teen Challenge in this New York town was to do what? And here are your choices. A, open the first Teen Challenge thrift store. B, open a small Christian coffee shop. Or C, open the first Teen Challenge women's center. What do you think, Rebecca?
I'm going to go with C.
And you would be correct again.
Woo!
I think this is a first. Good job.
I was really going to be dumb.
Yeah. All right. Here is your bonus. In 1962, in Pennsylvania, Mr. Frank Reynolds built what was known as the farm. He built it from the ground up. What exactly was the purpose of the farm? And here are your choices. A, to train horses in equine therapy to help men with emotional issues. B, to train men as disciples of the Bible and later become the model for Teen Challenge centers worldwide. Or C, to be a dairy farm to raise money for the New York branch of the Salvation Army. What do you think, Rebecca?
I think B, a training center.
A training center, and that would become the model for Teen Challenge centers worldwide. Well, yes, indeed, you are correct, which means you got them all right, and no fluff machine, but we will give you this. We got a little bell for you, and we'll send you a high five through the phone there. You got it? Bam.
Right on. I got it.
Yeah, you got it. All right. Good job. All right. You get to keep your job for another year. Isn't that great?
That's winner.
All right, so that wraps it up for another little fun game of Teen Challenge trivia here on the Victory Report.
Yippee-i-yo-ki-yay, Monty Man.
Thank you, Cecil. All right, well, folks, Teen Challenge, Adult and Teen Challenge, Teen Challenge USA. There is really, literally, hundreds of these centers around the globe. And, you know, I probably the three most popular or well-known recovery-based discipleship programs would be the Salvation Army, Victory Outreach, and Teen Challenge. Teen Challenge currently leading the way is in numbers of centers across the world. And it really does take a special kind of person, a person who is called, not just burdened by, but called to the ministry of this kind of work, because this is front lines work. And Rebecca Owen is our guest. She is the executive assistant to the Reverend Snow Peabody, who is the state director of Teen Challenge of Arizona, past president of Teen Challenge USA. And Rebecca, you're in a staff position currently. And we had a lot of fun just a minute ago, but there was a time in your life you weren't having so much fun, right?
No, sir.
What was going on back then?
Just a lot of compromises and the expectations I thought I was supposed to uphold, being a single parent, maintaining lifestyle, all of it was just small bits of compromise to where needed to polish the outside and make it look good when the inside was just dying inside.
Wow. So you were kind of trying to polish up the flesh then.
Yeah. Yeah. Just, you know, stay afloat, make sure I work each day and provide for my daughter and don't need no help from anybody. Very self-centered mm-hmm. mentality because of being a capable young person. And I thought I could maintain it all. And eventually it blew up in my face.
So addiction is a broad term. It does not necessarily, it's not necessarily limited to substances. It can be behavioral issues. What was the big thing for you? Did you have a problem with substance abuse or no?
I did. When I was younger, right out of high school, I did have a problem with methamphetamine and cocaine and the lifestyle I had jumped right into right out of high school and struggled for almost a decade with that.
Wow.
Until, which actually this last August, I celebrated 16 years from never using dope again.
Well, congratulations. And that's a great milestone.
It is. Especially, and I stopped one day, and God absolutely had his hand on that because one day it was no more. My daughter was too sick, and I was too high to notice. And I picked her up and walked away from my lifestyle, how it was. And that day, I never touched it again. Dad usually takes the treatment center or some support or whatnot. And God just cured me that day from ever touching it again. But I traded it for putting my nose down to working and alcohol. And when you say that, you know, not all addictions are just drugs and alcohol, it's not. There's a work became a huge part of my day-to-day need to excel and to achieve and to make the most money possible for the type of job I had with no degree and a child to provide for. So you're right when it's not just drugs and alcohol that can be an issue. And it threw me in a down spiral, and I found myself drinking here and there to a point to where I'm drinking every morning and drinking all day long to a point to where I was never really drunk or sober. It was just this consistent, and everything was failing until one day I realized I needed to tell a best friend, and I did, and that was the day that started my footsteps towards Teen Challenge Home of Hope.
So okay, so take us through this kind of metamorphosis that took place. So you were using what many would consider hard narcotics, and then you made a shift to focusing on alcohol. Did you ever think to yourself, or did you ever say to yourself, well, at least I'm not doing hard drugs?
Absolutely. And you know, I never was a drinker ever.
Mm.
And even when I did start, it was a little here at the holidays or at the end of a rough week. And because it was never a part of, here I'm almost 28 when I started drinking, I had never had before. So it wasn't a thought that I was numbing.
Yeah.
Feelings, issues, what the enemy was placing in my head.
Sure. Sure. So you were minimizing what you were doing. Were people around you concerned? Did anybody approach you about what was going on?
Not really. It's because I'm, you know, I got up every day. I went to work. I paid my bills. I actually worked a couple jobs to make sure that, you know, we lived well. And I had a couple people tell me a few years ago, actually, that I was the most well-kept alcoholic that they had ever met.
Mm. So you were very functional.
Concern.
Yeah. So you were very you were a very functional alcoholic. You were somebody. Well, you had to keep your job, right? Because you had a daughter. Of course, you have to pay for your alcohol, and so that's got to keep going. Did you have a relationship or any idea about a relationship with the Lord at that point or any time during that time?
Absolutely. My grandfather was a minister, and unfortunately he passed before I was born, but my grandmother, my mother, my family, growing up in our family, we definitely knew the Lord, went to church. And then when I graduated, I left family, faith, and met my first husband and ran a very radical life. And then I walked away from that life, got divorced, and met someone who was very stable. And until 3 years later, his addiction came into our marriage. Mm. And that's when he went to the Tucson Men's Center here in Arizona. And that's where I first really was introduced to Teen Challenge. And watched his progress, watched people around that I've met, and how the Lord just steps in and can heal. And when our marriage didn't work out, I just plugged my nose right back into working and didn't keep God as first or as my savior or as my protector. I figured if I worked and had money coming in and we ate and everything was good and I was getting a promotion, everything was going to be okay.
Well, during that time when you felt like everything was going to be all right if you just did certain things, did you ever have that empty ache inside that said, even though these things may be working out, something's missing?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And, you know, at times you thought maybe it was because I was single. So it was, you know, I didn't have a gentleman there. Or it was because, you know, it was several things, but then I would turn and look and at least I have my daughter. You know, at least right. I have my friends, and I would keep myself busy. There was hardly ever any time I was just home relaxing.
Uh-huh.
Where I was at one job, or I was at another job, or at a family event, or house sitting, or traveling. I just kept myself busy.
Yeah.
Ignored it.
So busyness can actually become a distraction, keeping us away from recognizing what the real core issue is, and then it just becomes something that, well, we just don't seek help for a long time. And we're going to talk about when you made that transition to actually getting help. But did your husband succeed in Teen Challenge? Did he go from the induction center to the ranch, for instance? What was the story there?
Yes. Yeah, he did. He did the Tucson Induction Center and then went through the Christian Life Ranch up in New River. And then ended up interning for about 6 months back at the center in maintenance and ended up moving on, got a job, moved on. He's remarried and having a really good life with the Lord.
Yeah. So it really, we look at some people, and those of you who are listening, many of you may be going, well, you know, that sounds all well and good, but you don't know my loved one. They're never going to change. There's just no way. They're too deep in their addiction or they're too deep in their self-centeredness. We've tried everything. Maybe they've even tried a Teen Challenge Center. Who knows? But they think they're at the wit's end, and there's no way this guy or gal is ever going to change. Would you say that that is a lie?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
100%. 100%.
Have you personally witnessed people that would appear to be a hopeless case change?
Yes. Many sisters throughout. I did 13 months at the Home of Hope, and I watched women come in with, it didn't seem like medically they were going to even make it through the withdrawals and have a beautiful life right now. I've watched it even working here and hearing the miracles of things that are happening right now in their program that they swore it could never, never happen.
So what was there like one event or what happened to cause you to, because you were already introduced to what Teen Challenge was doing. What happened to get you to where you put your foot into the program? What was going on?
Well, when I finally confessed to a friend how much I was actually drinking, they took me to a hospital here in town. I went in at the beginning of February, and I was in ICU for 17 days. And I left the hospital a month later in a walker and completely weak, yellow, and went into a local here in town center, completed the program, and started drinking within a week. I relapsed a couple times, and that last time I was at my house, and I woke up the next day in the hospital, and my cousin walked in and said, "You're going to Teen Challenge. We're not going to watch you die. You're going to do this because we love you." And I did.
Were you hesitant or angry or combative?
No, something just, I know when we say it was something in us, it's really God.
Yeah.
It was, there was no more fighting. There was no more trying to control things. There was nothing for me to move forward with all the decisions I had been making. And those decisions were self-destructive. I was not going to survive. And
yeah.
it was hard to say yes, because then you have to admit what you've done. But that is not the worst. That is just the beginning. And it ended up being, it's rough leaving and going, but each day you find yourself a little bit more.
So practically no one likes to admit complete defeat, right, Rebecca?
Yeah, especially someone who is strong-headed as I was.
Yeah, yeah. And I'll tell you, those of us who have lived through active addiction, whether it be substances, thought addictions, one of the things I teach in one of my classes is about an addiction tree. And there's, every tree bears fruit, just depends on what kind of fruit it's going to produce. And there's thought addictions, there's feeling addictions, there's activity addictions, there's substance addictions, and people addictions. And to admit complete defeat when we've jumped from one to the other, trying to manage our own lives and not doing well at it, it can be very uncomfortable when the covers are pulled off and everything is exposed. But that's where the healing begins, my friends. That's where it starts. It's going to be uncomfortable because there is healing and recovery in the battle. And you went through a battle. That certainly is true. You came into the Teen Challenge program. When you walked into the Home of Hope, which is the Women's Center, when you walked into that, were you scared? Did you feel like you were at home? What was your first day's experience?
First experience, I was very still jittery from, because I had been on antidepressants for a couple years,
mm-hmm.
and I was still trying to come off of that, but no, it was more of the fact of I didn't understand how a day-to-day was going to go, so I kept quiet for about 7 days, so I can see what each day was like and what the expectation was, not thinking that I was going to a place to finally just fall and cry and to say, I need help. I wanted to figure out the logistics of what was expected out of me first.
Hmm. And did you find a welcoming, loving environment?
Absolutely. Absolutely. It was different. I'd never really experienced something like that. You only see it on TV. You only hear about it from friends that have done it,
And yeah.
What's ahead of me was 12 to possibly 15 months in. It's an overwhelming number. And, you're immediately surrounded by a lot of ladies and just wanting to say, hey, how you doing? Staff just giving you a smile, letting you know that you will get through this, especially when staff members themselves have gone through the same home, did the same program, understand exactly where I was at that moment.
And that is really one of the most powerful tools in our arsenal of tools to fight active addiction and life-controlling issues, I want to make sure the listeners understand that, is the fact that the majority of people that are actually working on hands with students at these teen challenge centers have been through the program themselves. They've experienced some pretty horrible situations in their life. They've come through a recovery process. They have recovered from a seemingly hopeless state of mind and body. And then they take what was given to them by the power of God through these wonderful folks at Teen Challenge and are passing it on. And that's part of not only sobriety, but that's part of experiencing a piece of heaven on earth, isn't it, Rebecca? Giving it away?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Pain, regardless if they see it as an effect of paying it forward, if they know exactly that's what God has called them to do. But without people knowing exactly where you are at and where you're coming from and what you could be, I believe makes the world a difference.
Yeah, yeah, you bet. Had you made any attempt of sobriety in any other kind of programs or treatment facilities for any length of time?
When I left the hospital for, it was a 3-month program, I excelled and achieved it within 2 months and promoted from there to start drinking within a week. And that is my only experience in my life. Try to get any kind of help. You know, I've always been that very proud and capable person. And,
yeah,
you know, my life started with a family member, a cousin of mine. She was kidnapped and murdered. And so fear was instilled in my family.
Wow.
We learned to live through. And that nothing is scarier than that. So when you just buckle down and say you will get through this, you'll get through this, at the whole time leaving God completely out of the factor, which didn't get me too far.
Yeah. Yeah. And in fact, one of the things I like about, really the beginnings of a life of surrender is that we need to come to a place where we understand that you cannot change what you don't acknowledge. And we need to acknowledge that left to our own devices, we are powerless over addictive illnesses and behaviors and substance abuse and entitlement and self-centeredness. It overtakes us when we're left to our own devices. And it's so interesting to me because one of the things I love about the faith-based recovery movement as a whole, whether it's Victory Outreach, Salvation Army, Alcoholics for Christ, Teen Challenge, whatever, is that we understand very well that we are left to our own devices. And then when we move to a place of dependency upon our Heavenly Father, we're no longer left powerless. We now have a power.
And I'm not defined by my circumstance.
Exactly. Now, and I like to explain this as often as I can. You still have to maintain a healthy relationship and walk with God on a daily basis, right?
Every day.
Yeah.
All day.
Because we are still, like, if I'm allergic to peanuts and I eat peanuts, I'm going to swell up like a balloon, and then I'm going to go to the hospital, and they're going to stick me with a EpiPen. And while I'm in the hospital, I'm in recovery from my peanut allergy. But
yep.
But once the swelling is down and they release me from the hospital, I have recovered from my peanut allergy. Am I still allergic to peanuts, Rebecca?
Yes, you are.
Yes, I am. And so as a house swept clean, we need to keep a vigil over that new clean house, or the demons, if you will return 100-fold. So we need to keep a vigilant eye on our walk with God. And I think a lot of times people will go to treatment and go, okay, 30, 60, 90 days, I'm done. I've gone to a couple of 12-step meetings for about a year. I'm okay now. And they go on their merry way And what usually happens, Rebecca?
The enemy seeps in. It may be an immediate attack. It may be slow. And then things will just overcome you, and anything is possible at that point.
Yeah.
You could go to the same thing you used to have. You may seek out another kind of addiction. You may want even chaos in your life. That can be an addiction.
So does the Home of Hope and Teen Challenge of Arizona, I'm asking a redundant question here, but do they teach you how to walk with the Lord, how to be a discipler with the Lord outside of Teen Challenge? So when you go home, you are more prepared to handle life on God's terms?
Absolutely. I remember sitting with the center supervisor and the director, and they're like, what do you have in mind? How do you see this? Mm. And we kind of went over some things. They had some opinions. They had some tips, excuse me.
Yeah.
You know, we worked about it. We talked about it. You know, I played it smart because some people, they're calling us to stay and intern.
Yeah.
Me, I had a teenage daughter. I wanted to go home. I needed to be home with her. So a good support group, plugged into a church already, and a job, you know, to keep yourself going, not keeping yourself idle, not letting those moments where, you know, well, just maybe I can do this. A good set plan was absolutely something I had even before my promotion date was given.
So you're being taught these skills, and a lot of folks come in, they haven't learned a lot of basic life skills. And surprise, I mean, I knew a guy just recently who really had no idea, and this sounds really simple to some people, but hear me, folks. He really had no idea how to properly brush his teeth. That wasn't his fault.
Yeah.
That wasn't his fault. No. But it became our responsibility to show him something very simple like that. And he was amazed that somebody cared even about that.
Yeah.
And
you know, that reminds me, my first day in the classroom, the teacher had come to me and she was giving me my first curriculum and started to talk to me. And then she goes, you know what? I got to ask you a question. Do you know the name Jesus, or have you ever seen a Bible? And I looked at her so floored that that was even a question being asked.
Huh.
And I said, well, of course I do. And I said, why would you ask that? And, you know, with all honesty with her, she goes, some people come in here and have never even heard his name and what he did and what he gave and his love for us.
Yeah. Yeah. We make an assumption sometimes. We make an assumption sometimes that everybody we're working with is a born-again believer, and that's a dangerous assumption because a person can have an emotional experience and go up to the altar and not be born from above. They can just answer an emotional call, and how are we going to know if we're not discipling them? And I think that's a great question. I think it needs to be asked of every student that comes in, not to pass judgment or be critical of what they believe in, but to find out exactly where they are. And I think Teen Challenge does that very, very well. I think a lot of times our recovery programs will sidestep the God issue because they don't want to offend anybody. And yet I'm like, you know what? It's better to offend somebody and save their life than to pat them on the backside and say, oh, it's okay, and then watch them die, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. You know, careful hands didn't save me.
Yeah. Right. Firm but never harsh, but sometimes it's got to be firm. And so you go through a curriculum. You go through several months. Sometimes it can be very challenging, but that's kind of the earmark of change, is that there is challenge involved. And I'm sure you didn't change everything about Rebecca overnight. In fact, I'm sure you didn't do it. I'm sure God did it through you. But you had to cooperate, right?
Absolutely.
Were there times when you did not want to cooperate?
Yeah, there's some frustrating moments. I mean, you've got a house full of women.
Right.
a lot of women.
Yeah.
You know, but, you know, sometimes when you're when you're amongst a group of people that have a struggle. It may not be the same exact one as you, but it is a struggle. And, you know, it's either the frustration of what you're refusing to see in yourself that you are fixated on someone else, or just at a moment where you've had to peel so many layers and so many realizations about yourself that you need to face and not allow the enemy to turn that into shame and go against everything that God is just opening up his arms to say, here I am. I love you how you are. Let's be what I have wanted you to be all along.
Amen. Amen to that. So, Rebecca, how's your relationship with your daughter today? What's going on in your life today?
Oh, it's busy. My daughter is amazing. She's a junior in high school. She is very active. She is a cadet with the local fire department. She is an auto class president. And she's a part of the band. So I've been playing band mom for the last few months, going on competitions and tournaments. It's been amazing. But we have our home and our two furry animals. And just getting back to that, it's almost like as if none of that ugly existed, but even better because we can talk. We can communicate. I'm a present parent to her instead of a busy and inebriated parent.
Right, right.
So,
and one of the things I love about the name of the center, Home of Hope, is that there is hope in hopelessness. And we don't necessarily believe that. We're in the middle of our mess, but it is absolutely true. So explain to the listeners why this isn't just 30, 60, 90, why this is a year. Why does it take that long?
Well, if you even want to look at it, how a doctor explained to me, it takes 90 days for even a body to become used to whatever you've changed it to.
Mm.
But the year, there's time. You need to give yourself the time to get over. And if you just go for 90 days somewhere and do something for yourself, it is super easy to step right back into what you used to have. There's six units in the curriculum that they gave us, so it was something a little bit deeper, but at the same time, a portion to strengthen yourself, to have confidence in yourself, to rebuild yourself to a person that you want to be outside. To change a lifestyle, it doesn't happen overnight.
No.
And we would love, a lot of people would love that. Anything that you want to do and you achieve, even in your life right now that you have of something and you see where it could be 6 months from now, it takes time to get there. And everybody's got to be willing to put their best foot forward for themselves and learn to re-love themselves, exactly who they are and what God wants you to be.
Well, amen. Truer words have never been spoken. It takes time. We didn't get there overnight. And it certainly isn't going to get all put back together overnight. But I'll tell you, you know, I read a book, and I hated this book. when I was a student 30 years ago, it was just 2 years after the Teen Challenge Center, the first Teen Challenge Center up here in the Pacific Northwest had opened. This was 1985. The education coordinator handed me a book. He said, Monty, you're full of pride and ego. And I thought, how dare you? I mean, I am not full of pride and ego. I'm the most humble guy you'll ever meet. I mean, well, right there proves that I had tons of pride and ego. But I really didn't see it. And he gave me a book. It was called Will the Real Phony Please Stand Up? Now, when you read a title like that, you get very defensive. You know, it's like, why are you making me read this book? And it wasn't a very big book, but I don't remember a lot about it, Rebecca, but I'll never forget this one statement. And I've held on to this for years in working with other people that have life-controlling issues. It stated, when you catch the ball outside of the end zone, You get the game the way it is, not the way it was. But it didn't stop there, because that can be kind of depressing. And then it said, the good news is you can get it back better than it was, but it won't be the same. And oh. I am telling you, it changed me, because I was living in all this shame and embarrassment and everything. And this book was telling me, you know what? This is not going to be easy. It's going to be different, but it can be better than it was before. And I think, I know, I've watched this happen with people that have come through the Teen Challenge Ministry and are living as productive members of society, many of them in ministry, sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ and hope with others. And I know you've seen it too. And you are working in a position now as the executive assistant to the state director. What do you do as executive assistant? I mean, you must see a lot of stuff.
Well, he is a very busy man.
Yeah.
You know, I was in a position kind of like this before, and I understand that a person that has a couple hats and the responsibility that they have need day-to-day support and help, and that's where I am for him, to ensure that he has what he has and what he needs to move from the next meeting, trip, or whatnot. I mean, he's an amazing support to the White House during the opioid summit right now.
Right.
He serves on the board. He's a member on some other ones. He's our regional director. And each day, just seeing all what can come across and just glorify the Lord in the work that he's doing nationwide.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
It is nationwide. In fact, he was here in the last of September. I believe Snow was actually in Washington, D.C., was he not?
Yes, he was.
Yeah, yeah. And so he's an advocate, not just for Teen Challenge, but for the recovery community as a whole, standing in the gap for all of us. And I can't say enough about the man. I've met him probably five times, and every time I meet him, I walk away humbled and blessed. And
absolutely.
Yeah.
It's amazing when people, you know, I was going to say nationwide, but our world is fighting so many different addictions.
Oh, yeah.
And when our nation is finally coming together to put a stop to ending and seeing our children and our loved ones die, and they all congregate together to figure out what's the best option, and then they look at Reverend Snow Peabody and want a faith-based opinion on what can happen, what can change, how we can fight this epidemic.
And, you know, there's a lot of bad news and a lot of bad press out there surrounding the political flavor of the day. And we're getting bombarded with a lot of cynicism. And, you know, and Christians ought to be the most joyful, cynic-free people on earth. But yet we can fall into it, too. But the deal that I want the listeners to understand, there is amazing progress being made to break through the problem of addiction and chemical dependency, particularly in the light of the opiate epidemic. There's a lot of stuff going on behind the scenes that people have yet to see. And I'm telling you, my friends, it's positive work. It's moving in the right direction better than it ever has. And it is largely due to the faith community and people like Reverend Snow Peabody and the Ministry of Teen Challenge. And Salvation Army, and some of these others coming on board. And people are starting to say, well, maybe you guys got it right. And I think they're waking up, Rebecca, don't you?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I mean, everybody has the end game of,
right,
you know, no more of these drugs taking our loved ones. But that can't happen in 90 days. That is the reach that it has. And now with fentanyl being thrown into it, it's lethal. It's immediately lethal. And it's starting, the opioid deaths are starting to surpass other killers, breast cancer. The amount of deaths in a year are tripling. And, you know, it's not going to be just because, hey, you can't do this anymore. It's going to be about what's going on in your heart. How can, what can we do to help you? How can we see what God's love has for you and how special and precious you are?
Amen. Amen. Listen, folks, there's a way you can support a student, by the way. Rebecca, you guys have a sponsorship program, as we do, in Arizona. Tell the folks how they can sponsor a student.
Absolutely. You can sponsor a student whatever you are able to give on a monthly basis. You can personalize it to a certain center. We have 5 centers in the state of Arizona. We do ask for a $40 a month sponsorship, but if you can only contribute so much, that is great because it literally helps as a student when you're trying to figure out how can I get a birthday card to my kid. And there's money there because someone donated to help you through. And it's just the little things that those things give is profound to someone who is just trying to start their whole life over. If you go to teenchallengetcaz.org, you can go to any center you'd like or just contact the sponsorship department. And any donation is a blessing.
And you can write the student you sponsor that you can communicate with them, right?
During my program, yes, you could receive a card. You don't really have too much correspondence. You can get a gift. One time it was a horrible day, and I got this heart-shaped wall decorative thing that says, if God leaves you to it, he'll see you through it.
Amen.
Today, I didn't think I was going to get through. Mm. And then my sponsor sent that gift, and it changed my day. That was actually a day I wanted to walk out, and I didn't because that surprise saved me.
Yeah.
That day.
Yeah. Yeah. See, so folks, sponsorship is so vitally important. Another way you guys in Arizona raise funds, and this is pretty common amongst all teen challenge centers, is you have the season of banquets. And boy, you guys,
they're coming up.
Woo! You guys got them going on. Yeah, November 12th, you got a fall banquet hosted by Springboard Home. On the 13th, you got another fall banquet hosted by the Tucson Men's Center. On the 15th, you have the East Valley fall banquet. And then the 16th, Greater Phoenix area. On the 17th, you have another one, Scottsdale. I mean, you guys are just and these things, listeners, these things are a blast. We just finished up our Western Shindig banquet out at the Shed Center here in the Pacific Northwest. And everybody dresses up like cowboys and cowgirls. The whole multipurpose or the gymnasium turns into a Western town. And it is just a ball. And all the centers across the world, they do this. And you guys are in banquet season right now. And that is huge undertaking, right?
Absolutely. The PR department has created a wonderful banquet. And just it's been busy a few months for them, to say the least. But, you know, our theme this year and to reach out, you know, I mean, our theme this year is prevention, saving lives.
Mm.
And that is the whole goal, to save lives. They're introducing the Safe Sharp program where they can go into youth groups and schools,
yeah,
and share just what a life can be without anything that controls you. But these banquets, the testimonies that you hear, the presentation that's given, and the love and the worship that goes on, it's an amazing night. If you can make it to any of these, you will leave with your jaw dropped.
Absolutely, absolutely. So you can go to the website, tcaz.org, click on the events link, and you'll have all the information there as well. Also, if you're looking, listen, you don't have to live in Arizona to be a student of Teen Challenge of Arizona. You can go to tcaz.org and find out information. If you are looking for a center closer to your area, simply go to teenchallengeusa.com and click on the center locator, and you will find hundreds of centers across the United States and the world. They're ready and willing to help you or your loved one recover from a seemingly hopeless state of mind and body. Rebecca, thank you so much for sharing your story and spending time with us today.
Absolutely, Monty. Thank you so much.
It has been an absolute pleasure to have you on. And please give that boss of yours a big hug for me.
I will.
All right. Well, listen, what we love to do is share some recovery-focused music whenever we close out any of our shows. And this show is no different. Now, this song comes from the New Creation Choir from the Teen Challenge of Southern California from their new 2018 CD. This song is called Liberty. Check this out. You're going to love it. It is rocking. Good old-fashioned gospel choir. Listen, I'll tell you, if you can testify like I can testify that we've been set free by the power of the God who is God through his son, Jesus Christ, well, we have liberty. That is absolutely for certain. A special thank you to my guest on this month's episode of the Victory Report, Rebecca Owen, the executive assistant to the executive state director of Teen Challenge of Arizona, Reverend Snow Peabody. It's been a pleasure to have Rebecca on. Listen, remember, if you want to sponsor a student, all you got to do is go to tcaz.org. Contact them. You can help save a life. And remember, my friends, that because of his grace, because of his love for you, you are royalty. Until next time, this is the Monty Man for the Victory Report, wishing God's perfect serenity for you. Bye-bye now.
Hallelujah, 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 thank you. Yeah, yeah.
This has been a broadcast of Take 12 Recovery Radio and KHLT Recovery Broadcasting.